website.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Ross Patterson Revolution! Brought to you by GhostBed.com!
Oh, look at us.
I know.
Good to be back behind a desk today.
You're a real boy.
I'm a real live boy.
You're a real live boy, and you're coming. Well, we're not live, but.
Well, we're tape.
We're a real live boy. Yeah, no,
I think this is our last day of tape shows,
yes.
And I believe we'll be able to go live tomorrow. A lot of people said that they could see my package on screen yesterday. I was wearing shorts.
Didn't we say something about it?
I think you did, and I just didn't care, obviously.
Right.
You know, look, there's nothing I can do about this package underneath the Christmas tree, okay? All I will say that I am exactly like Santa, and this gift is for the world.
Right.
You know?
Right. Did they feel that way?
Who?
The messages that you got. Was
the
it?
The people, yeah.
Uh-huh. Was
yeah.
it like... We loved it so much, or was it?
Yeah, it was a lot of like spirited children running down the stairs. Like I got a lot of those gifts.
Were they like 4 more years?
Four more years.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I was like,
of that.
Could be 12.
Right.
You know? Yeah. Of that.
Right.
Jabes.
Right.
So the people were amped, you know, and it's nice to give them what they want.
Uh-huh.
They want a little bit of the D&Bs, you know.
Hey
the twig
guys.
And gigs.
I've gotten a lot of messages. Just wanted to hop on here real quick and let you know you're welcome. That was on purpose. I've gotten so many messages about my package.
Who, me?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't get that many messages about my package, Jessie. Mm-hmm. So I don't even know what that was for.
Hey, guys. So I've gotten so many messages.
Here's what happens when you assume things like that, Jessie. You make an ass out of you and me. And that's what you've done here.
Okay, I'm just going to grab my stuff.
On our new studio, you have dirtied it already. Look, kids, if you're watching the show on YouTube, you're going to say, holy shit, this is a really nice brand new studio in Austin, Texas. Yes, this is the Drinkin Bros set. We've gone all out for the new studio. And I don't want to say we're better than kind of everyone else, but we're better than everyone else. The beauty is when you have a fucking director, a Hollywood baby, getting behind the captain wheel, we're going to get some cool shit finally. We needed some more talent. And Austin, Texas definitely had that talent. Clearly, this set is incredible. And they're building Ross Patterson Revolution. So that should be up in Adam in a week. In the meantime, we are on the Drinkin Bros set right now, and it's beautiful. I mean, I'm very impressed.
Yes.
I am never impressed with a lot, but this is awesome.
Yes. We really got some good set decorators. I think that was the difference.
Yeah. Look, there's a lot of movies that are shot here in Austin, a lot of production that goes on here, and you know, you're able to pick off people like that.
Right.
In Wilmington, everybody had left. The tax break went away. Therefore, everybody just kind of scooted on down the road to Georgia.
Are they still there? There's no way.
What's that?
Are they still there?
Still there.
Okay.
Still there. They're still doing those tax breaks. And, you know, I watched an interview with Tyler Perry the other night because I love him. Huge Madea fan. Huge.
We respect him.
Good morning. What's his? Oh, hello. What's it? What's,
is that what his is?
I don't know what he does.
Oh, okay.
He's got a couple catchphrases that Giorgio is always saying throughout the office.
What are you talking about?
He's a huge Madea fan.
You have to respect Tyler Perry, right?
I
think
do.
What you will of Madea.
100%.
Dude, he's still shooting.
Yes. And
he has
in
made
this,
a quarantine studio.
Correct. In this pandemic.
Yeah.
He's the first studio that opened up and is fully shooting everything.
Fully shooting.
Yeah.
You have to stay there. You're quarantined there. You
correct.
Cannot leave. But shit.
Here's
the
thing.
These people are working.
Yes. And I wish, look, man, this is going to be extremely rare where I talk about how great Tyler Perry is, but we're actually going to lead off the show with that. I wish every business looked at it the same way. And truthfully, that is what's wrong with Hollywood. Tyler Perry isn't Hollywood.
No. His studio is.
Look, he was the first one to get the fuck out of there and build a studio somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And I know what you're saying. Hey, man, Robert Rodriguez moved to Austin first and Tarantino and those guys. They did. And they have a couple airport hangars that are dope, right?
Mm-hmm.
However, Tyler Perry has built a studio in Georgia that is bigger than Paramount's, Warner Brothers, anything you have in Hollywood. And he said, fuck you. I'm going to take my own money that I've made, the billions of dollars that I've made, and make my own studio that is bigger than anything that Hollywood could possibly pork out.
Mm-hmm.
Because let's face it, that land in Hollywood is too expensive. So he couldn't do it there. Therefore, he said, all right, where can I do this? Well, how about my home state? I'm going to take all this money, put it back into my community, back into my home state, and hire people from my home state, which is something that I have championed for years on this show. If you want to do something, and you can't bitch that Hollywood's not giving you the opportunity, go do it yourself. Tyler Perry did it all of himself. And then he took all the money, got out of Hollywood, and went back to Georgia, and then opened up this, I mean, just palatial spread there. I think he has 11 sound stages there.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what he did? He named them all after famous Black filmmakers and actresses and people that he admired in the entertainment industry, even though they hated him. So, like, Spike Lee fucking hates Tyler Perry.
Why?
Hates him. The Madea thing that we were joking about earlier is a common Black stereotype of, hey, man, put on the dress and the wig and be a woman and dance, right? And it's in like a lot of movies.
It's like our Ernest goes to...
Correct. But the Black community... it's 50-50 on it, where they're like, hey, man, this takes us back to old racial stereotypes.
His bank account will tell you different.
Correct.
And the theater, the ticket sales will tell you different.
Now, me personally, I think Spike Lee is correct in this, where it's just like, yes.
For sure.
It sets the culture back 50 years, right? However, if you're going to do something positive with the money, like Tyler Perry is doing, and is there any bigger revenge than to say, all right, cool, man, you hate me? Awesome, man. I'm going to name one of my sound stages after you. We're going to shoot on Spike Lee stage 10 today. I don't know what the final verdict was between the two of those guys, if they ever hashed it out or what they were able to chat about afterwards.
Right.
But I think one of them is named Denzel Washington. One of them is named Will Smith. One of them is named Oprah. Spike Lee, I want to say Halle Berry maybe. He said, look, man, these are the people that inspired me. Therefore, I'm going to name my studios after them, my sound stages after them. And we're going to get people working. And, you know, what is most important during this time? Your family and money? Or we're going to go out and bitch that we don't have a job and live off of unemployment. Like, he went to all of his people and said, hey, man, we need to keep everybody working. Therefore, let's shoot in a bubble. Everybody come and live here. And what was it? The interview we saw was, I believe he shot an entire season of a TV series in 23 days.
Three shows. Three different shows. So not just three seasons of one show. Like,
whew.
All different shows in different sound stages, different times.
Yeah.
So it's quite impressive.
Again, it is,
think what you will of what he does. Fucking A.
You're on a soap opera shooting schedule at that point, almost doubled, which soap operas, by the way, I will never shit on, because that is the hardest work there is. Not only as like an actor and set, you know, set designers and all that other shit, but like, dude, that entire crew and cast is running all day long. You cannot fuck up your lines in soap operas. You know, if you do, they put your scenes at the end of the day because they always run long and it's punishment. Mm-hmm. So for the actors,
mm-hmm.
It's almost like a kind of like a boot camp where it's like, hey man, if you fuck up, everybody else is doing 50 push-ups.
Right.
That's the way it is. So it's like you get two shots. If you get two takes, if you screw up your lines, congratulations, we'll push them to the end of the day. You're going to stay during hour 14 and 15 and make the crew stay and all that other stuff. Everybody's got to be on top of their game. Tyler Perry is essentially doubled that schedule right now.
To be fair, they are soap operas that he's shooting.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. But he's doing it at double the pace
right
now, which is that pace is already insane.
Right.
I can't imagine doubling down on that. And here's why that is important for people working. Let's take the actors, right? All of their contracts, the writers, the actors, the directors, the producers, everybody, all of those contracts are per show. So it doesn't matter how fast he's shooting them. You're getting paid per show. And if you're gassing out that many shows, congratulations. You're getting your full paycheck for all of those, everyone involved.
Mm-hmm.
And that is great. That is not only great for television, because whoever's watching that shit is now going to have content, but it's great for all of those hundreds of people that are working on all of these projects. Whereas, you know, the state of Georgia was the first to open up, you know?
Yeah.
Big gamble.
Yeah.
Big gamble. You move your entire studio there, and luckily you had a governor there, Kemp, who just said, hey, man, we're opening up for business. Everybody go back to work, because the economy is more important than three people fucking dying. And it's paid off. Georgia's doing it right. They're in school, man. Those kids are in school.
Right.
I haven't heard any fucking problems from the high schools and everything else. Tyler Perry's shooting stuff. Movies are starting to go back to work in Georgia because of it. And if you want to look at the other side of that spectrum, big companies are failing. American Airlines just said, hey, man, when this stimulus package runs out here in October 1st, we are now cutting 30% of our workforce. American Airlines. Now, their stock is already teetering anyways, right?
Right.
They were headed towards bankruptcy. They were the first airline that said, hey, man, we've got to fill up these seats. No more social distancing.
Yeah.
Or we are going to go bankrupt. I do not know how they stay open after this. And, you know, it's because of all this bullshit that's going on. You're going to lose American Airlines. If you thought flying was bad before, wait a couple years.
Wait until there's only
one airline left.
Or two.
Maybe.
I mean, how's Southwest doing? How's freaking Delta? I mean, are we just getting rid of American Airlines? Because they were like, not that great.
What happens? Look, was American Airlines great? No, they weren't. But what happens is, and this has happened over the years, the planes get bought out, they go into somebody else, and, you know, the danger is you get down to a monopoly where you're just down to one, and
yeah.
Then if they fucking suck, that's everyone that fucking sucks.
Yeah,
if
you think customer service sucks now,
yeah.
Wait till there's only one airline in the game, and they know you cannot do anything
about it. Yeah.
It's always the best. No leverage.
You're screwed.
Good luck dealing with an airline with no leverage whatsoever.
Higher prices. And if you thought they didn't give a shit about your bags and everything before, congratulations.
Congratulations.
It's going to get so much worse. Because now they're like, well, fuck it. You don't have another option to fly. Tarmac.
Right.
Let's just try to throw it into the hole under the plane. No need for the conveyor belts anymore. Let's just chuck it on in there. See what happens,
yeah.
You know? The best example of it is the United States Post Office, right? That shit, as much as everybody bitches about, oh, we're going to lose it. They haven't been great. It's not like they've ever been that great where you're like, oh, man, USPS is awesome. It takes a while to get shit. Therefore, the necessity for a FedEx and a UPS came around. Otherwise, everybody just would have used that for years and been like, nah, it's great.
Right.
No, you couldn't get things that fast. FedEx came into the scene. UPS came into the scene. I would not be surprised if Amazon jumps into this game as well and opens up their own thing.
Well, they are, right? So you see I see the
trucks now, mm-hmm. But the next is shipping, airlines. Will there be Amazon airplanes?
I think they have that.
Do they have that now?
I think so.
Yeah.
But that's kind of the problem, is you don't want to have the Postal Service in any kind of money-making position, right? Like, that doesn't feel right.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So you do want these certain things to not have any personal money gain, right? Like, you don't want to privatize fucking Postal Service. You don't want to privatize these things that, like... You know what I mean?
Well, the weird thing
then
is, here's the weird
it's
thing.
Based on how much you have. And
but here's the weird thing to me, right? all of the shit we get, and we get a lot of boxes to the goddamn house every day from Amazon, like, to the point where our old neighbors across the street were just like, hey, man, what are you guys doing? Like, are you ordering children off of Wayfair? Like, there is 9 boxes in your house every day.
Right.
It's not that. It's just that, you know, all of these things are on auto thing, coffee, everything in our life is pretty much auto ship these days, where it's like, dude, let's get food. Oh. Let's get, you know.
Yeah. Let me be clear. It's going to happen.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Sorry, but I didn't mean we don't want that to happen, so let's try and stop it. Like, it's 100% happening, yes. But that's what's, it's just one more thing that's going to make us.
Here's where I wouldn't, but here's
why.
It's
turning us into the dystopian society where we are ruled by Amazon yeah. and Google.
And Facebook.
And Facebook. Well, Fang. Zuck, not necessarily Facebook, but Zuck Enterprises, right?
Yeah.
And they have more power than the government. So once they take over, they're going to have their own voting sites. Do you know what I mean? Like, that kind of thing is going to happen. So we're not there, but we're on our way.
With Amazon, I don't mind it. And I'll tell you why. To get products in 48 hours, if it's on them all the way around and you can't blame anybody else but Amazon on that, they'll probably do it. If there was anybody I was going to trust in that world, it's probably Amazon. They very rarely miss.
Yeah. Right?
I mean, you might get an item that's fucked up because of you know, you're trying to pick clothes online and you're like, oh, I never have.
Amazon has never made a mistake.
No.
With me.
With you. I had a TV that was delivered that was smashed to pieces, and I was like,
right.
Hey, man. But that's about it. And so we've ordered thousands of boxes from Amazon over the years.
So Amazon is growing its fleet of cargo aircraft with the lease of 10 additional 767s planes that will add capacity to its delivery network. So it's happening.
Yeah. You know what else they're doing? They're buying up as well. Malls. Yeah. So if you live in a city right now where your mall is fucking gone, it looks like zombie land. They're buying that up, and those are going to be their distribution centers, and that is happening right now. It was happening in our town before we left, where it was like, hey, half that mall is empty. What are you guys going to do with the other half? And they were like, well, Amazon's probably going to come in and buy it. And I was like, oh, all right, that's where we're at. Well, shit. Bing, bong, bing.
Bing, bong, bing, bong, bing, bong, bing, bong,
Amazon
bing.
Rules the world, and I'm okay with it. I'm a fucking dummy who needs to be controlled and live my life underneath a careful, watchful eye of the government. It's a great song, actually.
It's really good.
The whole thing really flowed.
Catchy.
Really flowed.
Catchy.
James, your fave, though, is coming back.
What's that?
Cruises, baby.
No, never again. I went on my first and last cruise. So what is happening with that and why?
They're open. Cruises are back. And right now, for a limited time, tickets are very cheap.
Are they?
Yeah.
Weird.
$54. So if you want to... You're always wanted to take that cruise out there to wherever. $54 will get you there. However, I'm gonna warn you, when you get that alcohol bill at the end of the trip that slid underneath your door, it's gonna be around $2,000.
Yep.
Yeah.
So just be ready for that.
That's the beauty of cruises. I'm not sure if I told this story or not, but I was talking with Matt Best about it the other night when we were laughing about the cruise. Drinkin Bros cruise and how fun and out of control that was. And to be honest, it's probably a once in a lifetime thing where if you were there, you were there and
you were there
to see what happened and it was awesome.
I would love to hear if Matt would ever do that again. My guess is no. I can't believe he was on that one. And neither could he, by the way, but he did have a good time.
He did. Like, he had a good time and it was a fucking blast, but I'll never forget at the end of it, like, because, you know, they were like, hey, we'll give you an appearance fee and all that stuff. And I was like, oh, great, you know, whatever. We got the bill slid underneath our door. They were like, just keep ordering throughout the trip, throughout the week, and we'll just give you a receipt for it. Just slide it underneath your door, and we'll take it right off your
so
credit
easy,
card.
So easy, please.
No worries. You want to guess what that bill was?
No.
$1,700.
Really?
Yeah, dude. Because we were buying shots for people, champagne, popping bottles.
A good red.
Yeah, they were.
Instead
there
of like
was
a cruise
like a,
red.
A private restaurant on the roof of that thing that we went to, the steak place.
Oh, and yeah, and
like
then that just goes on the bill,
meal.
Too.
Yeah.
Gosh, anytime it's easy like that, guys, anytime you can just like
swipe a bracelet yeah.
Beware because that's how they'll get you at the end.
Yes.
Because you're like, how many times did I swipe? You can't remember. Whew. They can't remember.
So the shitty ones are open at $54 here. There is a high-end one that is open that is boarding in the Italian port of Genoa. Am I saying that right?
Genoa.
I've never been there, so not going to pretend it today that I have been there. So you can go for a 7-day Mediterranean cruise on August 16th. And
August 16th?
Yeah.
So it's already gone?
It's
this next year?
They're, that's when they started booking.
Oh, okay.
And they're trying to book 3,000 pioneering cruisers. It will be the first cruise liner to return to the Mediterranean after the shutdown. So,
are they letting Americans on? So,
we'll see.
Confused. So, like, yeah, of course.
I don't know how that's going to work.
Yeah.
I definitely don't know how that's going to work.
Definitely
but,
don't think they're going to be porting.
Yeah, the guy from the cruise company
anywhere?
Says, he goes, I think cruises could be the safest holiday right now. No, just no.
No,
that is not
no.
the safest thing to do right now. Is get on a cruise.
No,
all I keep thinking of when I read stories like this is about these cruises. Is like there was like 40,000 people who were stranded at sea for like months.
Oh yeah,
you would have lost all of your shit
yep.
inside of your body.
Yep.
And I think, and correct me if I'm wrong.
Sure.
I think at one point you just would have jumped off the side.
Something like that would have happened.
Right?
100%.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm pretty chill, but I also will be taken to the edge.
Yeah.
Fairly quickly. Pretty chill in life.
Yep. But yeah, I can see you just hopping.
Oh my God, I can't.
Hopping off. You know who did that? Was Street Bike Tommy. He jumped off. The cruise one time.
What cruise? Cruise?
Yeah, he jumped off a huge cruise. He was
bro,
black and
die.
Blue for the entire... It was pure chaos. It looked like he was going to die, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fully black and blue. I've never seen a body that like that.
Yeah, you definitely can't do
he
that.
He lived. He lived it. And there's
I
video
mean, clearly
of it, by
he
the way.
Lived, but yeah.
And I think there was a huge fine, if memory serves me correct, like $1,000 or something like that.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But he did it and he lived. So, you know, it's possible, Jabes. It's possible. You're a tiny human. I think if you straightened out.
Yeah, you think?
Yeah. I think if you went.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think you would
I
do
might
it.
Have just like stolen a dinghy or something, though. You
oh.
know what I mean?
Yeah, you would have gone full full Titanic on
mm-hmm.
it. Titani.
Titani.
I think you would have put yourself in a little dinghy.
Yeah,
and
definitely.
Lowered yourself down at night.
Definitely, yep.
Yeah, with one of those lanterns.
And I could have figured out how to do that. I could.
That's true.
If I look at something long enough, I can figure out how to do pretty much anything.
I think you can control a small dinghy for sure.
Yeah, I could get it down to the water.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you'd be fine.
Now, any kind of navigation or getting to anywhere that would make sense? Probably not.
Yeah, probably
but
not
But I could
for sure.
get the dinghy down and in the water, probably.
Yeah. Yeah, one would imagine you could probably get
probably.
That thing in the water. Probably, Jabes. My money's on you in that dinghy contest, for sure. For
Thanks,
sure.
Man.
I want to talk about the cocaine convention last night. A lot of cocaine. That's what was trending number one in America last night during this was the cocaine convention. You checked out. It was a long day yesterday. We've been working on the sets and kids and all the chaos. You checked out, signed up watching it.
Yeah.
Obviously for the people. I'm here for you. I don't even do this for me, to be honest
I
with you.
I saw the highlights.
I'm a giver. You saw the highlights.
I saw the highlights. I saw the speeches in which they which led to them naming the convention Cocaine Convention.
Yeah. So Kimberly Guilfoyle.
Sure.
Was screaming at the top of her lungs.
Yeah. And last look, night. If there had been a bunch of people there, it would have been fine,
so
right?
So I think that's the problem.
I
think the problem last night was you're so amped to get out there and make this speech. It is way different when there is no one there and you're in a studio like this versus 20,000 screaming people. And she went a little too high. What I don't understand is, did they not do a mic test before going on and say, hey,
she
can
didn't
you speak
peak
at your
or anything.
Exact level?
She didn't peak. So they did obviously check it because she didn't peak.
But what
she definitely peaked, though.
And so Don's Jr. was after her, and his eyes looked a little glassy. And obviously they're dating. The speculation was that both of them had sniffed up a little bit. Got a little sniffy.
And look.
At the RNC.
Who cares? Everyone's on legal speed anyways.
Yeah. Here's my honest opinion of it. You can't go on stage blasted out of your mind on coke. He's not that dude anyways. Fucking his dad, Donald
they're
Trump.
They're weird and
doesn't even drink.
A little bit awkward is the most I'll give that situation, right?
Yeah. I think
to
me.
He's not the greatest speaker, but.
To me, he's not bad.
He's not bad.
You want my honest opinion? He looked sick. Like he was fighting a cold or something. And it was just like, we've all had those moments where you just want to get through something. And, you know, you're fighting off like sneezes and all that other stuff and your eyes are.
What was her.
Watering.
Her excuse then.
Hers. Now that could have been Adderall.
Sure. Yeah. 100%.
I think it's a little hard to do some booger sugar and then go out there and do shit like that. But
let's not forget Joe Biden yelling at us like our grandfather.
Correct.
Like,
yeah.
That was not mentioned. Joe Biden's husband comment wasn't mentioned.
No.
By mainstream media, anyways. But for this convention, they went after every little tiny thing.
Yes. And I thought the rest of the speakers were good. Tim Scott was great. I thought
Nikki Haley was really great. Yeah.
I think it was all around. Last night was a win. Look, Trump led off. He's speaking every single night, which, in my opinion, looking at it, is very smart. If everybody's allotted a certain amount of time across all the networks, right? Now they usually save the president or the presidential nominee for the last night, but if you can take all four nights, take all four nights.
Right.
I mean, why not?
Yeah.
And I enjoyed it. Look, I'm here to see homeboy. So it was fine. But look, I'll give the Republican convention the same notes that I gave the Democratic convention. It is hard to just watch talking heads for fucking 2 hours, man, on television with no crowd or anything in the background. It's difficult and it's boring. And I thought, you know, as good as some of those speakers were last night, it's still boring to watch. Same with the DNC, where you're just like, man, you're talking to no crowd at this point, and it's not in a podcast setting. So
right.
You're kind of just giving a speech into camera, and there's only so much you can do. To me, the real winner was probably Nikki Haley, where I could genuinely see her running for president and being a great choice for the Republican Party in 2024. And if you're looking at that speech, she's only going to get better.
Yeah.
If you're looking at that speech last night, that seemed like a presidential speech to me,
right,
where I think she's got a very bright future. But you know, as far as whether or not it's entertaining, no, not really. That format just does not work. Now, what will be really interesting, though, will be Thursday night and Trump speaking. You and I got invited by some bigwigs in Texas to go to a political event for it, which I got you a ticket, Japes. So.
Oh, okay.
If you're in, you're in.
I just need to figure out.
It's True Texas, by the way. I will say that. It's True Texas.
What do you mean, True Texas?
You go in your pickup truck.
Okay.
They're going to put it up on like a drive-in screen. And, you know, you can party. We have VIP, you and I.
Oh, wow.
We get to meet the Texas candidates.
Okay.
Yeah. And there's some bands playing and all that other stuff. And they were like, look, if you're dead serious, this was the call I got yesterday. They were like, we know you were, you know, running in North Carolina. If you ever want to do that again, you should probably start to get to know some of these people. And I was like, all right, yeah, shit, let's do it. So if you want to go, we can rope it off. It's Thursday night.
Thursday night?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I can leave the kids with Dan or something.
Oof. Good luck.
They love him.
Yeah, they shouldn't. The kids will never spend another day with Dan, by the way.
He's a sweetie pie.
Last night, this is no lie. Last night, I'm playing with Jax. I took him to jiu-jitsu yesterday. Afterwards, we come back. We're playing on the couch. And he just walks up and punches me in the stomach. And I give him a little jab back, obviously. And that's our little game.
Sure.
And he goes, he looks at me dead in the eyes. And he goes, if you do that again, I will beat you to death.
Okay. Okay. And so you think Dan told him that?
How many times has Dan said on the show, yes, Dan told him that? It's not like he's watching YouTube videos where they're I will beat you to death. Dan says that over and over and over.
No, he
doesn't. Giorgio's laughing his ass off. You've lived with Dan for the last week.
No, he doesn't. He's a sweetie pie.
Yeah. Welcome to Sweetie Pies. I was like, where did you learn that? And he just laughed and he goes, I don't know.
It does
and I was
sound,
like, you know goddamn well where you
it actually
it.
Is.
Dan should yeah, not be around true. Children's.
He would have said that Dan, Mr. Dan told him.
Nope.
Dan, yes, he would
Dan should not be around children's.
Maybe he also told him, don't tell or I'll beat you to death.
And the children's should not be around Dan. We don't need children's learning like that, you know?
All right.
Think of the children's, Jabes. You can't have it.
While you were watching the RNC, I popped on the first episode of The Vow documentary series about NXIVM sex cult.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Dude, I wanted to see that.
Really?
Yeah. I love good sex cult. You know?
Yeah.
Whatever, man. Don't even wipe off. Just keep fucking. You know?
It's a weird one. It's a weird one. I knew a friend in LA that was part of it, but not not in that way, like the very lower level. It's same with Scientology, where there's like some people that are like, I didn't fucking see any of that shit. And some people that were like, yeah, I was fucking raised in it and beaten. And, you know, it's a full on cult. So
I will say this. So if I was going to get in a cult, it would not be religious. It would definitely be a sex cult.
There are always sex cults.
Well,
no such thing as a cult that has no sexual component.
As long as I'm not fucking dudes, like I'm down with it. Like, hey, let's,
and they usually fuck dudes for dominance. Like 100%, there's always gay shit just to make sure that they have you. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I got some power
over
you.
It's a definite tool. Scientology does it as well, so that they have shit on you that you don't want to get out.
Man, damn it.
I know.
It just shatters my hopes and dreams.
I know.
I don't want to do any gay shit, you know?
Well, then you don't... Look, it's very easy to not be in a cult, right?
Yeah, it is. But there's also a point where you're like, eh, I'll give that a go. I remember watching...
Just for community, do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's lonely.
I remember watching... What was the one that... You have the best pronunciation of it. It's up in Oregon.
Me, the Rajneesh?
Yes, that's it. That one, right?
Yeah.
Where you look at it and you're like, all right, if I was bored and I wasn't really doing anything and I just wanted to fuck a bunch of people, like, yeah, I could sign up for that for a couple of years.
I will say that was probably the only one that I was like, yeah, people are just fucking hippies and having sex with each other.
And doing drugs.
And doing drugs and kind of just living like hippie shit. The weirdest part of that was the money laundering aspect of it. But there
was nowhere near the weirdest part for me.
What was
when
the
they started shipping in the fucking homeless people. Like, that's when it got weird.
Yeah, okay, I'm saying like...
Because I don't want to fuck homeless people.
I'm saying like the sex cult part of it.
Right.
Where that one wasn't necessarily like the main Bhagwan, whatever.
Yeah.
Having sex with everybody, which is usually how it is.
Sure.
It was just everyone else having sex with each other.
Yeah, I just don't want to fuck homeless people. So I guess I should really revise this. I don't want to fuck... I don't want to do any gay shit, and I don't want to fuck homeless people.
Okay, well, it's going to be really hard for you to find a cult then that's going to work for you.
Damn it, man. That was
my
second half.
Yeah.
You know? Now
there's
you just
always
ruined it.
One of those things, if not both.
Gay sex and homeless sex?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Huh? I got to find something else in this life, you know?
I just didn't know you were in the market.
I'm not.
Okay.
If you die, though, where it's just like, all right, well, what am I going to do now? Might as well join a sex cult for a couple of years, you know?
And look, this Nexium one would not have been an issue for you.
Really? So what's the
sitch
there?
It was only groups of women with the main guy, Ranieri.
Great.
Yeah. So the guys that are in it were like, I don't know. It doesn't seem that fucking bad to me, right?
Right.
And you're like, yeah, because you weren't a girl that was branded and like, made to do like group weird sex stuff.
Did they get into that story with Homegirl from Superman?
It's episodes, so it was very early. So it literally just laid out the basis of the cult in a way that's not sexual yet, right? Like, so they just made it like, this was amazing, and we were living in a utopian world, and it was awesome, and we were all so successful. And then, of course, at the end of the first episode, there's one phone call that kind of, you know, lets you know that this is not a good thing. But again, like, cults are so interesting to me.
I know.
These people.
I picture a lot of Midnight Oil playing in the background, the cults.
Huh?
Midnight Oil, the band Midnight Oil.
There's no band called Midnight Oil.
Yeah, dude. Dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee. Come on, Giorgio, you know Midnight Oil, right? God damn it, man. I feel like I'm on an island.
Midnight Oil rock band.
Yes, dude. James, come on.
Midnight Oil.
You really don't know Midnight Oil? Like, this is crazy.
No, like, what? Sing a couple bars.
I just did.
Okay, do it again.
It was a massive worldwide number
one
word. Song.
Sing one lyric.
The beds are burning. How can we sleep when the beds are burning?
Oh, okay.
Man, The Dead Heart was one of my favorite songs. That's the one I'm humming right now.
Oh, okay.
We followed in the and we cannot be broken. How do you not know Midnight Oil?
I do now.
I can't. So here's the thing. We got flagged by YouTube when I played Bobby Shmurder. The other day, so I can't play this even on my fucking phone.
I think everyone gets it now.
That's what goes on in a sex cult. That's a lot of Midnight Oil.
Okay. I see that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe because he looks like the leader of a sex cult.
I don't understand how you get from I want to be a little bit more successful in my life and relationships to getting branded and having sex with the
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand how that happens.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Man,
how do you get to that?
It's pretty easy.
What is?
That leap, you know, that next step towards that. For who in particular? So just, like the girl from Superman?
Just anyone that is like a normal person that like
they weren't normal to begin with.
Okay.
So I think that's where I think it's your biggest mistake.
But these people do seem like
they're not, and that's the problem. So like most of the people I know who are in Scientology, right? On the outside, you're like, oh man, you're normal, right? There's a fucking dude. I've talked about my neighbor before who was a Scientologist, right? They got him because he apparently was an alcoholic back in the day.
Okay.
I didn't know it, but then. You know, I asked like, oh, hey, what's the thing there, whatever. And I was like, why did you get into it? And he was like, I had a problem with drinking, you know. He's like, it really helped me, and I don't have that problem anymore. And he's like, you know, now I'm just fine to have like one or two a day. And he goes, a couple beers, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, all right, cool, man. And he goes, it was maybe 1 o'clock in the afternoon. He goes, you want a beer? And I was like, yeah. We're out by the pool. I was like, yeah, sure, I'll take a beer.
Sure.
And he goes, great. Now, there was a pool cleaning closet behind the pool at this place that we live. And he goes, now it's in there in the back in a cooler, okay? Just don't tell my wife. So clearly he was still drinking and everything else or whatever. And I was like, oh, the guy that I thought was normal is hiding piss-warm red stripes in the back of a pool cleaning closet in an old igloo cooler. And That's what he was drinking, just to get through the day.
It's the same with, like, false confessions. Like, that, it's the same sort of thing where I don't understand how the mind does that.
I do.
Right? How the mind goes, like, I don't want to do this, but, and there's nothing holding me here.
Yeah.
Except for social construct. Like, that's, it's crazy.
So.
I guess I kind of get it, but in a way, no.
I'll go into, you know, like, look, obviously I was in a fraternity. Come on.
That's true. You were in a cult.
Yeah. And it's kind of what it is. So you go through this hell week of like 7 or 8 days. We have to do all this fucked up shit and weird shit together and everything else, right? And they keep asking you the same questions over and over and over and over to get this response out of you, right? I'll say this. Out of the, I think it was like 23 people in my class or whatever it was, 22 of them all ended up saying the fucking shit that they were supposed to say and do. And, you know, it's kind of meant to break you down just to say or do things. Mm. I was the only one who didn't. And paid the price for it because I went through last and I was locked in a room for, I think, 26 hours with my legs taped together and all that shit.
Okay, but you could have just walked out and not come back.
There's your answer.
And no one, do you know what I mean?
Right. But why don't
why
people?
Why didn't you?
Right. And that
why didn't you?
Right, well, because I knew, like, at Ohio, like on campus, like if you were in the Greek system, it was fucking epic and the parties were endless and women and all that other shit, right? I knew it. So I knew I had to do this stupid thing and go through this stupid fucking hell week to do the thing. But I wasn't going to give in to the stupid shit of like, oh, yes, most omnipotent. You had to call people. No lie, I don't give a shit now because they're shut down for like 5 years. But here's what we had to address people as, and I still remember it to this day. Most omnipotent, Lord High Paramount, Mr., and then their full government name. Yep. Yeah. So if you're telling me of like, oh, hey, why do people give false confessions and shit like that? I can tell you why. They're tired of being in the same place or ask the same questions over and over again. They just want to get the fuck out of there. And how do I end whatever is currently going on in front of my face? And that's why they do it. And so, like, you take that, the retard, the Brendan Massey kid, mm-hmm. right? Looking at that Making a Murderer when we were watching it, the kid just wanted to get the fuck out of there. And they're asking the same questions over and over and over and over again. And you're like, finally, after 2 or 3 days of it, you're going to get the answer that you want. If somebody's not strong enough, if their will isn't strong enough, you're going to get that fucking answer. With these sex cult people, something was dark in their past. Something fucked up happened. And as much as you try to stray away from it, you know, it comes back to get you eventually where you're like, you know, I'd like to dabble in that sex cult thing because something fucked up happened to me as a kid or whatever it was, right? Aren't most like pedophiles? Weren't they like molested as kids and things like that? And like yeah. That cycle's continuing.
Mm-hmm.
Same sort of sitch, I think. Nobody can ever, and that's the disappointment I have after this whole conversation is why can't anyone just enjoy a great sex cult, you know?
Right.
Just have sex and drugs and endless money and fun, you know?
Right.
Instead, somebody's got to go and fuck it up. That's why all these things end in a goddamn nightmare.
Yeah.
Start letting homeless people in. Ugh. Nobody wants to fuck the homeless people. And that Rajneesh bullshit we were watching, literally, what was it? Two people were like, man, it was so awesome until those fucking homeless people showed up.
Yeah.
And then they had to let them fuck other people. And you're like, ah, Christ. You probably had like 4 or 5 girls that they were banging. And all of a sudden, some fucking homeless dude comes in there. And now he's got to bang them too. And you're just like, God damn it, man. I don't want to go after him. You know?
If you lose your sex buddy to a homeless guy, though, were they ever really yours? You know what I mean?
If you love someone,
let them fuck a
homeless person. If they come back, then you knew it was meant to be. Speaking of which, shit, we just keep going. If you're out there and you want to fuck a homeless person, you should do it on a ghost bed. ghostbed.com/drinkingbros. I don't know if they have ghost beds at sex cults, but here's the thing. If you're out there and you're thinking about starting your own sex cult, do it on the finest mattresses in the land. Go to ghostbed.com/drinkingbros today and get yourself a mattress. to a bone on. They've got a Labor Day deal right now that's going on. Labor Day is upon us. Holy shit. Holy shit.
Is anybody laboring, though?
The SEC is, not the Big Ten. I can tell you that. 30% off everything. Bundle packages. Bundle it up. You don't have to do dick in this life. You'd be a fucking loser.
Bundle it up.
Bundle it up. You get 30% off everything. If you're now, if you're a member of the military or a first responder, or you're working the government, or you're a teacher, you get 30% off everything already. And congratulations, you're a superhuman. But now they're giving it to us regular dummies. You can do that. 36-month pay-as-you-go program, no interest. And bundle it up, kids. Finest mattresses in the business. Go to ghostbed.com/drinkinbros today. Next up, we got strikeforceenergy.com.
Boom, 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 boom. Shablankers.
Man, talking to Bruce Schley today. And
what's that old son of a gun up
what's
to?
What's that old SOB up to? Slanging that old dick around. Mixing up new Strikeforce with it. Look, man, they're making some new flavors. I'm not allowed to say what they are, but I'm amped about them. I just had a conversation right before we went on air. Gigantic fan of Strikeforce Energy.
We have been since day one.
Pumping through my veins. Oh, it's pumping through my veins, baby. Strikeforce Energy. That's how you're going to get to my level. If you want that Kimberly Guilfoyle level.
Yeah, exactly. That's what she was on. It wasn't cocaine.
Pop two packets of Strike Force in your mouth. And you ready to go? 10-pack, 40-pack, 750-milliliter bottle. Go to StrikeForceEnergy.com today. Promo code REVOLUTION will get you 20% off. I got it in my LaCroix.
Of course you do.
We're just moving into the studio, so we don't have like all of our shit yet. So therefore, I've just been drinking LaCroix that was left over in the fridge, putting a little Strike Force in it. I am with you when we do the show afterwards. D'Anthony is off camera, I believe. Was that the Google guy that was here? It's all set up. Google Fiber
the
is all
Google
set up.
Google guy.
Which means Google? We will be able to go live. Well, this will air after that, so whatever. Hopefully you watched this before on our channel. Subscribe to Drinkin Bros podcast and do that. But I'll be having some drinks with D'Anthony. You'll get to see the new set first before this one, which is the way it is, you know?
Yeah.
We'll be on this one for a few more days until our PR is set up, and then we'll be ready to rock. StrikeForceEnergy.com, promo code REVOLUTION, 20% off, though, best in the biz. Last but not least, Manscaped.com.
Oh,
what up, girl?
Sure, where you were going with
what
that.
What up, girl? You asked me this morning. You were like, hey, man, did you shave your fucking pits? I did. Dudes have to shave their armpits like twice a year. That's a thing.
That's not true, right?
It is true.
I fucking knew it wasn't true. He goes, it just keeps growing.
Giorgio's like, a dirt bag. Yeah. Yes.
Not shaving. You trim a little bit.
Well, here's the deal. So I don't have that much hair in my body. Mm-hmm. Therefore, I have to use the little electric razor. So, you know. It's easier.
Okay.
For me. I don't want to sit there with scissors. I don't have the time for that.
Right.
Therefore, put it on one. Good to go. Won't have to do it again for another eight to 9 months. And I feel fine. Shave up your pubes, your mouth. You can shave up your... They should change the motto to, you can shave up your mouth with it.
They should.
Just B-A-L-L-Z-Z-Z-Z-Z. Go to manscaped.com. All you need is a fucking kit. It's classy. You can sit on your countertop in the bathroom. Nobody's going to fucking make fun of you or wiggle your tits about it. Go to manscaped.com today. Promo code REVOLUTION will get you 20% off. A lot of people in the message boards right now talking about midnight oil. Totally kidding. This is pre-taped, so we can't see your message boards. But I guarantee you they're making fun of all of you for not knowing who Midnight Oil is.
I'm not sure that's
fucking
the direction that they're going, but yeah.
It is. Giorgio, at the end of this audio episode, will you play The Dead Heart by Midnight Oil just for the audience? Because they're going to be in their cars, they're going to be partying, and they need to hear that song.
Yeah.
You'll know exactly what I'm talking. It'll be in your head all day long.
Dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee.
I want to talk about the pool boy, by the way, because that was trending all day yesterday, and everybody hit me up, and they were like, hey, man, are people pissed off about your movie? And I was like, I don't know. It turns out the cuck, Jerry Falwell.
Oh, yes.
It turns out that dude was a pool boy. And if we haven't hit the stereotypes yet, we just have right now.
Right.
The pool boy was the one that was doing it. So now I understand that why that was 8 years. He didn't have a lot. Pool boys don't make a lot of money.
No. You know?
But if you want to fuck a rich dude's wife in front of them for 8 years.
So, but Jerry's saying that that
great
wasn't
for the income.
The case, right?
Yeah, of course he's going
to
deny it.
I'm just saying, I'm just trying to like get it straight. So one is saying that's what it was, and the other's saying, no, it was just an affair.
Yeah. Cool. It's ridiculous. Like, of course, dude, he was cucking for 7 years. And, you know, it is what it is. I understand from the pool boy's perspective.
Yeah.
Like, dude, you want to make some extra cash? He's probably making, you know, $8-$10 an hour.
Yeah.
Might as well bone a hot older lady in front of the husband.
For sure.
I don't know what he's going to do. I don't know if it was a requirement that he made eye contact, but, you know, good for the both of them.
Yeah.
It's kind of a win-win in my book. Not sure why this is all coming out now.
Like, but what's wrong with that?
I don't see a problem with it.
Is
if it's
just
consensual.
Because his stature, what he does for a living? Yeah, right?
Yeah.
Because he's
it's his business partner who came out and fucking outed him, I guess. But, you know, look, man, if you're into cucking and all that other shit.
Yeah,
like,
I just feel like there's nothing wrong with
that. I don't either. Victimless crime, right?
Victimless crime. And if he wasn't, I guess, in the position that he's in, then who cares?
Now, if you had to eat Falwell's ass, you know, as part of the deal, then it's just like, all right, Jesus, man, that's tough. But if you didn't, you know, look, cucking is a voluntary thing.
It's just, it's
so
fine.
The more and more of this story that keeps coming out, again, I really don't see a fucking problem with it other than homeboy
other
super.
Other than the hypocrisy, right?
Yeah, like, homeboy's super religious and, you know, practice what you preach. But look, I say this, if you're going to keep it in-house, it's better than going out and, you know, paying strangers to do it.
Yeah.
If you can get your pool boy to be your cuck boy as well, like, congratulations. It's a nice thing.
Yeah.
So.
Sounds like everyone's consenting.
Yeah. I don't know one of these fucking people on TV in religion who's not doing shit like this.
Yeah.
Weird shit.
Yeah.
It's like you were saying at the beginning, like, dude, religion and sex cults and all that stuff, they go hand in hand, so. Yeah, man, if the pool boy's fucking boning your wife and you were cool with it, you were paying him. Victimless crime.
Yeah.
So.
Seems fine to me.
Yeah, he was 20. He's going to, I think she was, and we looked at, we pulled her up yesterday. She's attractive, so what's the deal? What's Again, the as deal? Long as you, if you didn't have to eat his ass, like, who cares? You know?
Even if you did.
Ugh. That's too, then you're taking it too far.
Oh, then it's not okay?
Yeah. Because that's when it's like, hey, man, that's above my pay grade.
Sure.
You know, now if you up the price and say, look, I'm going to give you an extra 80 for you to give me a rimmer, then whatever, right? But now if you're saying, hey, this is now included in the price that I'm paying you, then we got some issues, right? We got some issues with it. I want to talk about an interesting story that I read this morning on Deadline, which is my go-to for like Hollywood shit, right? And they were talking about the death of sitcoms on the major networks, and I was like, I really didn't kind of notice it. And then the more and more I thought about it, I was like, shit, you're right. Things have gotten too PC that you kind of have to correct every joke, and I can't really name one anymore. Remember, there used to be a huge run of them for years, and it was such a cash cow, right? All the way back to like All in the Family and Cheers and
right.
Cosby and all that other shit. And now it's like, well, what's left? It used to be How I Met Your Mother, right? That was on for years. And like
that was a sitcom, yeah.
Who was Mike and Molly and all that other shit? Now, granted, I didn't like it.
Mm-hmm.
Chuck Lorre was the guy who did all those, like Two and a Half Men and Mom and all that other bullshit, but
right.
What's left, you know?
As far as sitcoms,
yeah,
Yeah, I mean, nothing, really. They keep trying new ones, but...
Big Bang Theory went off the air.
I guess they have Superstore. Modern Family is gone.
Modern Family is gone, yeah. Even that's on a traditional... Like, that wasn't a three-cam comedy, so...
Yeah.
But I remember when I moved there, it was the Holy Grail. Like, if you got a three-camera sitcom...
Right.
You were set for life, and it was the easiest job on the planet. You got your minimum salary if you were a lead on one of those shows, minimum salary. Let's say you were brand new. Jessie just got Friends, right?
Right.
Friends is another one. Shit. Let's say you just got Friends. You were making 40 an episode, 22 episodes a year.
Oh, yeah.
You were rich. When that re-aired, you got half that money because that was part of your residuals, and it was amazing, and you were like, yo. The schedule of sitcoms is so easy, too.
Mm-hmm.
You go in Monday for a table read. That's it. You're done for the day. Congratulations. You just read 32 pages of a script aloud with some buddies, and you had some laughs, and you had some tabs.
Right.
I think tab is probably still big to this day.
Right.
You're going to like the way you look. I guarantee it. And then Tuesday comes around. You didn't like some of those jokes. Let's take them out. Great. Here's the new script. Also, whatever you were wearing in that scene, we're gonna measure you up, make your wardrobe for Tuesday. That's it. That's your Tuesday.
Right.
Wednesday, a little blocking, a little dress rehearsal. Fucking A. No bigs, right?
Mm-hmm.
Thursday or Friday night, you shoot that fucker in front of a live studio audience, and then you're gone.
Right.
Easiest gig on the planet. It got so easy. That guys like Frasier, they eventually were like, hey, man, we don't really need you for the table read anymore. Pop in on that Friday night and just shoot that show and you're good to go.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And now that's all gone. By their own doing, though, I will say. Like, after reading this article, I was like, oh, well, everything's so goddamn PC now. What can you put on?
Right. But also, it must have something to do with Netflix and streaming, right?
It does.
It's because no one's watching.
But here's the thing. Netflix will run out of money. Their debt is enormous, by the way. And a lot of people don't know this. They're like, oh, man, Netflix, dude, their stock is through the roof, and they're the greatest network there is. They have borrowed, I think it's like $7 billion to make all this content. Because you got to pay for it somehow, right? And
right.
Make up for it in subscribers later on down the road in the projections of those subscribers. But the problem is everybody has Netflix. I don't know one household that doesn't have it, right?
Right.
So what happens when you just run out and you got all this debt? Eventually, you're either going to have to sell to somebody or you're going to have to start popping ads in there. And then what does Netflix become?
Right.
A network. That's all it is. Hulu does it now. And I fucking hate it.
Right.
I'm so used to that Netflix model that I'm like, dude, get these goddamn commercials out of my face. We were watching Yellowstone trying to catch up when we were going throughout this movie and everything. And we had to watch 50 fucking commercials on the Paramount app. Ugh.
But that was the network as well, because it was just.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's a little bit different just because it's the show that was just on actual TV that you're watching streaming afterwards.
Yeah.
So
I'm curious as to where this goes, because here's the other part of this is you take these shows like Friends or Seinfeld or The Office, right? You need to rerun those somewhere. Therefore, like, that's what makes sense to me of like a Netflix to come and involve or become involved in and shit like that is like, all right, great. We'll buy your back catalogs. So that way we're not paying for all the production and all that other shit and blah, blah, blah. So I think you still need networks to do this. I just think, man, comedy these days. Forget it, dude. It's too PC. You can't fucking do this shit anymore.
Yeah.
You know? But it's strange. When they were like, when I read the headline, I was like, no, that can't be true. There's that one show. And I was like, oh, that's it. There's just that one show. Mom was the only one I could name that was like a half hour thing.
Right.
Last Man Standing, I think, was on Fox maybe. But
Last Man Standing is here. Life in Pieces, that's Hulu. Goldberg's, Blackish.
Oh, Goldberg is still going on. Yeah, you're right. You're right.
Blackish. But
Goldberg's and Blackish aren't three-camera sitcoms. Like, those are
okay.
Those are shot pretty well. Good friend of the show, Christine Lakin. She directs a lot of those Goldberg episodes.
Yeah.
That's a long gig because you're not in a studio. So like you're, you know, going out and shooting this shit in real time and blah, blah, blah. But yeah, the three camera sitcom is kind of dead. Strange.
I'm cool with it.
I knew you would be, James.
What?
I knew you would be, you know?
What's your favorite three camera?
I used to love, even as a kid, like Cheers. Cheers was okay. Awesome to me. Like all through growing up, Cheers, Seinfeld, Friends was great. The Office. The Office is single camera. You're right. Friends.
Was Friends three camera?
In that era. I know this is really shitty because it was the worst series finale in the history of comedies. How I Met Your Mother, I thought was great.
Right.
Neil Patrick Harris, MPH on that was amazing.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed that show. I thought the casting was great and all that shit. But
News Radio.
News Radio was good. Joe Rogan was on that.
Yes, he was.
Phil Hartman was on that. Spade was on that. David Spade was on that. Like, there's some good ones, man. There's some really fucking funny people out there.
They put Reno 911 on here. Amazing. Not a three camera.
Single
sitcom.
Camera. Yeah. Single camera show.
Golden Girls.
Reno 911 is fucking amazing.
Golden Girls.
I think
Fresh
I've seen every
Prince.
Reno 911. Oh, dude, Fresh Prince. Come on, bro. So they're remaking Fresh Prince, by the way.
Yes.
As a drama. You know that, right?
Yes.
After that guy's trailer, they are remaking it as a drama. And I will say, if there's ever a time to do it, it's probably now. Right? Everything that's going on in the world?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's going to be good.
Yeah.
They are remaking. I just saw the trailer for Karate Kid.
Oh, you know why?
But with them.
Yeah. You know why?
It's really funny.
Wait.
It looks really funny.
So Karate Kid has been on YouTube for like 3 seasons. You know that, right?
With the what?
The original cast.
Okay.
Are you saying they're making a new one without the original cast?
No, it's I just saw the trailer.
Oh.
For Netflix.
So here's the deal.
I don't know if it's a movie or a show.
It's a show. So this has been on for 3 seasons on YouTube, right?
Okay.
It was pretty successful. YouTube is getting out of scripted altogether. That's how hard it is. If YouTube can't afford it, and they were just like, "Yeah, we can't afford this." Netflix stepped in, and they were like, "We'll pick it up. We're good to go with this, and we want your back catalog." So that's why you saw that trailer. It is now on Netflix.
Got it.
And they are doing it. And you know, look, that's a different part of that business model of like, "Hey, man, let somebody else pay for 3 seasons. We'll pick up that back catalog and keep this popping on down the road."
Right.
So that's what they're doing. I saw that trailer as well. Same thing. Yeah, it's the same show.
Got it.
So, it's strange to think that it's dead because I think it could work. I just think these jokes, man, going into these table reads, like, can't get away with anything before.
Right.
Who's the Boss was in this article. Used to watch that.
Oh, yeah.
As a kid, Alyssa Milano, before she lost her mind, before she died from COVID. R.I.P.
Yeah, before she lost all her hair from COVID.
Strange to see. Strange to see. I would love to see an Office reboot, though.
Yeah.
It's just comforting. And Steve Carell's decisions now are horrific, and he needs to just be Michael Scott
just
and accept it.
Just go back to,
I don't understand why you won't accept it. I just don't get it. I know I've said this before, and I'll say it again. If St. James, Street James, if the book series got made into a series, right, and that is all anybody called me for the rest of my life, St. James, Street James, I'd be fucking amped about it. Congratulations. For real. Like, to create
one
character.
No one would argue with that, yeah.
What's that?
No one would argue with that.
But here's what I'm saying. A lot of actors would bitch and say, I'm more than just this one character. To me, if you create one great character in this life, you should be proud of that.
Yeah.
Like, the best is Bob Vance Refrigeration, another friend of the show, Bobby Ray Schaefer. He loves being Bob Vance.
Yeah.
Loves when people stop and say Bob Vance or whatever, and it was just like, he loved that character.
Yeah, that's true.
And I don't think there's anything wrong with that, whereas Steve Carell has an issue with it. Me, again, if people only want to say St. James, great, that's great. Or Vandenham, I get that everywhere. Ooh.
Yeah.
Everywhere I go, great, dude. I fucking love that movie just as much as you. I love when you fucking scream that out.
Right.
It's awesome, man.
Right.
But for whatever reason, Steve Carell's got a problem with it.
Mm-hmm. He wants to be a dramatic actor.
Stupid, man.
Yeah. Well.
Stupid, huh?
Well.
A lot of people talking about Jesse's idea of Yellowstone yesterday. And I know Giorgio loved it. The Mexican version of Yellowstone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yellowstone.
Yellowstone. So
I got a little bit of a look from Giorgio that was kind of like, maybe don't. And I was like, I'm Mexican. I can say that, Giorgio. If I wasn't Mexican, I wouldn't be able to, but.
Yellowstone?
Yellowstone? Stop.
Here's the beauty of me too. Like, is I think you're hilarious like all day long. So I always let you go with this. Like, I will never cut her off, Giorgio. Like, I just won't. So
so that's the problem is I'm looking to like you two dummies to be like, was that too far?
No, it'll
who
never
am
be
I
too
looking
far
at?
With me.
Yeah.
It will never be too far with me. And there was a point last night. I think it was right before I was going to go right. You were going to bed and you just go, hey, real quick. Did I take it too far with Yellowstone yesterday? And I go, no,
you didn't. It was funny. I was like, maybe that was my litmus right there.
Yellowstone.
If you tell me it's good, I know I've gone too far.
Yellowstone. Man, they're trying to push us out of East LA. This is our home.
Actually, I'm in. I mean, the more you talk about it, the more you talk about it, the more I'm in, actually.
Yeah, and like the John Dutton, you know?
Yeah.
It would be Juan Dutton.
Yeah.
Juan Dutton, and his hold over the land is he's the one person with cable service, and then it's like he's got all these cords going out to all the houses, like other houses in East LA, and it's just like, man, you want to take my land? I'll take your cable. And it's like, you'll all be paying for fucking cable, Holmes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that would be the ultimate flex.
Mm-hmm.
and Yellowstone.
Yellowstone, but yeah.
Yeah.
It's
he controls the one cable box for all of East LA.
Oh, boy.
By the way, I can say that because my neighbor, my very first neighbor, my neighbor in Los Angeles, he was a cable provider.
Mm-hmm.
And every time he got a call to East LA, he was like, fuck, man, I know exactly what this is.
Somebody
like,
cut somebody.
Yes. Somebody cut their line.
Yeah.
Cause all they do is siphon them off to, you know, one person has the box and they siphon them off to everywhere else. And it's like, somebody cut this one line and I've got to go deal with all of their bullshit of like why they don't have cable. And it's like, hey man, you didn't pay for the service and you definitely don't own a cable box.
Real quick.
So you don't get to call me and I come out and fix your fucking issue with whoever you're siphoning cable off of.
Right.
Yellowstone. I think it's a great way to end the show, Japes. If you're out there, please go to iTunes and rate the show a 5-star and leave a quick review. It really fucking helps scoot us on up the charts until Spotify buys us out. And we never have to deal with YouTube again. Speaking of which, real quick, Rogan put a post up yesterday, and he goes, hey, guys, just want to let you know, September 1st, so in 6 days, all video shows will be available on Spotify. Spotify, give us a call. I am done with the YouTube algorithm, my man. Love you, Jabes, and Yellowstone.
Yellowstone.
YouTube will probably throw us off for that, but just know I stood by that joke, and I still do. For Jesse Wiseman, a.k.a. The Jables, I'm Ross Patterson. This is The Revolution. Good night, everyone, and buenos noches from Yellowstone.
Good night.